This is a Cokes interview brought to you by Louder Than 10, the school for people who manage digital projects. We're building a community for freelancers, digital PMs, and creative teams by sharing stories about the experiences that tie us together. You can find us on louderthan10.com, on Twitter at louderthan10, or on Facebook. Hi, everyone. I'd like to say a huge welcome to my new guests today. We're going to be doing our monthly Q&A podcast. And today we have three awesome and super talented digital PMs. They're hailing from all over North America. And every one of them has a unique story about what got them here and what they're doing to explore the field of digital PM in their own way and actually kind of set it up and make it their own. I would love to introduce my very first guest, Natalie Semchuk. Natalie is a former graphic designer turned freelance digital PM. She works remotely with small agencies and her cat and development shops. She's also the founder of the DPM Upstate New York Project Manager Meetup Group. And outside of work, Natalie is a regular at local yoga classes, the wine bar, and generally posts far too many photos of her cat, Ned. You can also find Natalie on Twitter at Talkin' That Talka, and I will give you guys all that information towards the end. Our next guest is Larissa Scardato. Larissa is a digital PM at Lane Terraliver by day, and outside of work, she volunteers her time as a chapter manager for, is it AIGA Arizona, right? And founder of DPM Phoenix, a meetup designed for project managers in the digital space. And if you want to make nice with Larissa, make sure that you use your homonyms correctly and bring her a scotch. Our final guest is Tara Caldwell-Simon, fondly known as the Southern Belle with Yankee Flair. Tara is the Director of Client Engagement for Atlantic, BT, and Raleigh, North Carolina, and she's got over a decade of project management experience. So when she's not sprinting from meeting to meeting, she'll actually be at breweries, traveling, and educating anybody that will listen on why football is the greatest sport around. So welcome, Tara. Great to have you all today. How's everybody doing? So let's start. It's probably the most standard question we ask, you know, and I think it's the reason is because no two people have the same story, and that is, how did we start out in this field? So let's start with you, Larissa. Tell me, how did you end up in digital project management? And let me know, too, if you wanted to be a DPM, like if you remember what you wanted to do when you were little or not.
Sure. So when I was little, I wanted to do archaeology. And then thought I'd probably end up being a lawyer, but I actually ended up studying art history in college, and when I was getting my master's in that, I was teaching at Arizona State, and a friend of mine, my best friend from college actually, was working as a content strategist, and her agency needed a project manager, and the ROI for art history professors is not so great, the student loans you need, so I decided to apply out of the blue, and somehow I got the position and absolutely fell in love with it, and now I'm here to stay.
That's pretty fascinating. So you had an education background that brought you in. Mm-hmm. That's interesting. Yeah. I also do. I have that. I have the high school English, so weird how that works out, isn't it?
I feel like it, yeah. I mean, I think education is probably a big part of project management in dealing with your clients, so it just kind of comes naturally to me.
Yeah, that totally makes sense. Cool. Natalie, tell us about how you ended up in digital PM.
We know you I was in school for design, graduated with my master's in sociology, my bachelor's in design, and didn't really know what I wanted to do. I was doing some freelance design while I was looking for a job, and I took an internship at a small local agency doing actually SEO research. Because I had the research writing background, and that was what was open at the time. And I would take small design jobs on the side. Sometimes the agency would throw me design work or branding work. And I moved into an assistant project manager position because that was what was open at the time. And I realized that I really enjoyed directing the client interactions and engaging with clients and sort of being that liaison between design and development and clients way more than I liked, you know, just doing one part of it. And I used that design knowledge to sort of help drive my understanding of the process. But from there, I loved the project management side and had very strong mentors and kept going with that.
That's so cool. So did you find at all, Natalie, that you were like surprised by just how the whole thing fit together and how you just slipped right into that role and was like, wow, this is super fun. What was it like for you?
Yeah, it kind of everything made sense together when I was doing that. I mean, you mentioned like what we wanted to do as kids, and I always wanted to be in charge of things. I loved being bossy. I'm the oldest child. I'm sure that's part of it. But I really liked piecing together those patterns and using that knowledge to sort of direct where things were going. So I think project management is a really natural fit in that way. It's a lot of puzzle solving and getting over challenges and then figuring out what to do from there.
Yeah, and it's, I mean, super cross-disciplinary, right? So, I mean, sounds like so far all of us have a variety of different skills, but I'll let Tara answer that. So, Tara, how did you get into it?
So, I went to school for broadcasting. What I really wanted to do, I actually wanted to do sports broadcasting. And the way I sort of fell into project management, it sounds like that's kind of what all of us did. So when I was in college, I ended up getting an internship with the local news station and realized I hated the news. Like, I didn't want to have anything to do with it, but it led to me getting a job with a production company that involved me being on-screen talent for a show that came on before NASCAR. If you're from the South, you understand a lot about NASCAR. It was a really big deal. But I found that I was too busy trying to actually like put together the show, like do all the planning, the running around, and I never really wanted to be on screen. I actually wanted to do all the other things that made the show work out well, and that's how I fell into project management. So I ended up taking a job as a production assistant at a production house, and then they moved me to like an associate producer to then a producer, and that's how I fell into project management.
That is so funny. What a, like, all of us, such random stories. Hey, they're like, I'm almost curious. So think about the people that you know who are other digital PMs. Do you think that any of them have a more traditional pathway? Like, what's the percentage rate of the people that you know, how they got in?
I think it's really low, the people that maybe either A, set out to do this or have that traditional background. Like, I have a project manager that I work with, and his background is very traditional. You know, he has like business background and worked for an engineering firm as a project manager and has his PMP, but this is his first spot doing something purely digital, so it's almost entirely new for him, even though he has like that foundation of knowledge. But everybody else I know is very random, like either design or development or art or something in their background.
Yeah, no kidding.
Yeah, I would.
Go ahead.
I would say like the most traditional path that I know of is coming from like a creative director, art director, or some other manager position, but even that is still a little abstract. But yeah, I don't know anyone who's come into it from an education background in project management. And I think part of it is there's not a really well-structured program for digital project management or even understanding of what it is, but that's sort of the beauty in how we find our way to it, because we have that skill plus a background in something else, I think.
Yeah, I don't think anyone ever goes to college or goes to school with like the mindset of, I want to be a project manager. You know, it's like people that don't know what we do day to day, like they all look at us as either like, oh, you're a glorified secretary, or you're a cat herder, or you just do a bunch of different things. And no one ever really thinks about it as like, we're kind of the backbone that helps make sure that your project stays in line. And like for the most people that I know that actually kind of fell into this position, you know, the way all of us did, is the most traditional path I've seen is like they start out as more of like a product manager. So they're at a company and they're given like one particular product that they're having to work on and oversee and make sure that it works. And then they find themselves having to pick up more and more products and projects. And that's how they kind of fall into the path that we end up in.
Yeah, no kidding. That makes sense. I was going to ask you guys too, like, do you think that the pathway that, like a more traditional pathway, PMP, is there any differences in the qualities of the people that you do know who have that sort of historical skill or experience? Or do you think that where we land is the same place in terms of how we deal with problems and how we approach things? Like, what's your take on that, Tara?
Like for me, I've realized for those people that I've worked with that have more of the traditional like PMP certification, they're very much by the book. It's almost like they have to have a process for their process.
Right.
And if something has to kind of go in a different direction, like if your timeline falls back, it throws them completely because they don't have that checkbox that they can look into and like, okay, I know if I complete this, then I can move to this next step. For those of us that work more on the digital side of things, and you know, no qualms to anyone that has their PMP, like it's a great way and a source of education, but it keeps you more on those traditional methodologies of project management. For those of us that work in digital, every single day our job changes, and we have to understand how to kind of flow with those changes. And we don't stick with one type of methodology. You know, it's not just agile, it's not just waterfall, it's not just grow or whatever the new one is today. You know, we have to be able to be, you know, lean on our own and nimble and know how to make the changes and roll with the punches.
Absolutely. Yeah, I agree with you completely on that. Larissa, did you have anything you wanted to add?
Yeah, I was going to say, I feel like with the PMP, there's this sort of, yeah, there's this definite, like inner meaning of structure almost to it. And being in the digital space, I feel like there's so much, like, you just need to be confident in being able to handle this level of organized chaos that isn't really chaos, because you, as the digital project manager, you know what's going on. But I think not having that formalized structure in our background really helps us to be more nimble and kind of think on our toes.
Yeah, I agree. I think, my background is a lot similar, very similar to yours in that way. I think with the education background, I remember I actually used to make fun of my husband Travis for checking his email multiple times during the day, because I would be like, well, why would you need to do that? I didn't understand what web design or development was. And then everything changed. And all of a sudden it was like that nimble knowledge that you have to take and just use. It was like I could put it into practice right away. And I think I was going to ask you guys, so some of the methodology and the approaches, since all of us came into this kind of by accident, where did you learn, your sort of formal skills, like project planning or contract writing or estimating and scoping? Like, what was missing in that sort of set up for you? Natalie?
I was really lucky to have two really strong senior project managers at the first agency I worked at, and it was a fairly young and small agency. They were around for maybe 7 years when I started, and the two project managers there, the senior project managers, had basically built the system from the ground up and tried everything before settling into where their process was. So I had very strong examples to learn from, and that being said, I still learned the hard way, I think, from everything I did, all of the sort of typical downfalls that you hit with projects, I learned through experience. And so there's something to be said by, you know, actually going through that and seeing how it goes wrong. You get a better sense of how those projects feel from the outset. But I think that kind of rounds back to what we were talking about with the PMP. Like, it's great to have all the theory, but you learn so much being hands-on and doing it the wrong way or the right way and getting a feel from it. So I really learned by example and from strong mentors, but also from just doing it myself and kind of seeing what everyone else was doing, seeing what I was doing, why it might have gone wrong, what my clients were like, what the projects were like, and going through the motions first.
Yeah, no kidding. So just to clarify, none of us here have the PMP, right? None of us? Would you guys, would you recommend someone get it then because of that, sort of having the formal knowledge, or do you think that it's something that you'd be like, well, you could, but really there's no, you know, advantage? Or maybe there is an advantage, but tell me, Tara, tell me what you're thinking.
So for me, I think get experience doing project management before going down the path of trying to get your PMP. I think it, you know, project management's not for everyone, and you may find that it's not the right path for you. So instead of putting the time and energy into, you know, taking the course, and it's not an easy course, you know, make sure that you're comfortable with what the job is, and then if you feel like it's something that's absolutely necessary, then absolutely go for it. But you know, it's not something that's required. Like, the best way to become a project manager is by doing project management.
Yeah, definitely agree. I was gonna say, Larissa, did you? Would there be any other certifications that you would be interested in taking, or any of you ladies, but start with Larissa, like anything else that you would want to do in order to kind of strengthen your role as a PM?
I mean, I've considered getting my certified Scrum Master certificate. I know the company that I'm at currently has offered to pay for that, which is really fantastic. So that's definitely something I've thought about, though at the same time, I really don't feel like it's something that's necessary. I think a lot of the more progressive agencies and companies are really headed towards this concept of project agnosticism. And so really getting your foot in the door and trying to figure out what works best for the project, for your team, and for your client's cadence, I think that's honestly the best training you can have.
Yeah. What do you think, Natalie?
I agree with what Larissa said, and I really like that term, your client's cadence. I think that's a really good term, and I want to reuse that. But I've considered the same certification as well for Agile, and I don't know that it's absolutely necessary. I don't work with anyone who sticks extremely closely to that, and I think a lot of the benefit of not having those certifications is that you can get more of a feel of what your client needs and what your project and team needs, and you don't feel the need to stick so closely to an actual method. I don't think it would hurt, but I don't think it's super necessary for where I'm at least.
So what it sounds like to me is, I mean, the biggest benefit of our positions is the ability to be so flexible and to have an understanding of all these different approaches and methodologies and even workflows, right? But not to maybe sink ourselves into any one. Do you think, Tara, that that's kind of an approach that has worked for you? And, like, would you sort of think you would recommend that as well? Or what's your take?
Yeah, absolutely. I actually do have my, like, Scrum certification. My company paid for me to do it. And I actually found that it has been helpful because as our company was moving more down the path of, you know, running projects using sprints and being more agile with the way that we were handling our projects, it came in really handy because it helped define who we are from a project management side, from a process perspective, and helped get a new rhythm going into the way our company runs things. But it's different with every company. I think, honestly, like the biggest thing that we do realize is that, you know, we learn by doing. And having someone, you know, having communities like this, you know, where you can go and watch a podcast or like meet people at the Digital PM Summit and, you know, get sort of this own community of project managers that can, you know, help educate you on how to do things better. I think that's the best resource out there available for any project manager or anyone wanting to be a project manager.
Yeah, I think so. I think it goes back to building that community, which I think it's pretty amazing. I was gonna say to backtrack the way that I actually met these ladies. Like, I think we all kind of met at the Digital PM Summit last year, but for the record, like, I had to leave early and we didn't get a chance to hang out, all of us. But since then, I think it was Carson. He set up. I just blanked on Carson's last name here, but he's been a pillar of the community, and he actually set up a Slack channel where we could all kind of, you know. I mean, let's not lie. We use it for, I mean, supporting our work and making sure we've got the tools, but we also use it just as almost like a camaraderie, right? And it's a way to know that it's like we're not alone. I don't know about you guys, but like I've been toying with the idea of setting something up for Vancouver like that. I don't, maybe you've already got a channel like that, but I was thinking, okay, what is the effect of having like 300 people in a Slack channel? Do you guys think that's a dumb idea?
I think it's a really interesting one. I mean, I've seen that set up for so many communities lately. Like, we have a local one up here for, there's a WordPress development group that meets. So they have a Slack set up for that. There's another group set up for craft that I'm a part of. And I think they really allow, like, they facilitate this really casual conversation that maybe you wouldn't have on Twitter because it's not as easy or it's too public there or something like that. And you can post questions like, hey, what do? I have this client that's, like, very frustrating and I don't know how to handle it. Or, you know, I haven't encountered something like this. So for us as project managers, it's been great and can kind of casually hang out too. So I think it's totally worth setting up for other communities.
Yeah, that's cool. Have any of you guys tried that in your own community otherwise, like with any other sort of digital PM stuff, or what's kind of going on in that front? Larissa?
I know for DPM Phoenix, like we have the meetup chapter on meetup.com, but we've started to play around with the discussions board there. So we'll post occasionally, like if I have a friend that is looking for a project manager, I know we've got a whole section just for maybe people that might be looking for something or if there's really great positions available. And then we've started doing it for, there's one that has technology listed in there and people will occasionally update it with new technologies they discover. We have another one where we kind of will post like notes from different meetups and then people will respond and ask questions. But I would like it to get to something more like a Slack group where people are chatting back and forth. I think that'd be really great. So I think it might take a little while in Phoenix.
Right. It's like the live help aspect. It's kind of like a forum, mm-hmm. but all the best qualities, right?
Definitely.
Cool. And then, Tara, did you have anything else you wanted to add about like community or anything that you guys are doing that's kind of exciting?
Yeah, like over here, like our company ended up starting, it started out for more of design. We do what we call as a crop meetup. And so we have where we'll host like once a month, we'll bring in UX, design, front-end developers, project managers, and we do a series of, you know, sort of, it's almost like a lunch and learn, but it's after hours, you know? So it's like, if you have people that want to be able to learn more about like their skill set, or they want to know like what others are doing, we started sort of developing our own little like design community here. And it's a great resource because now it's gotten to be where like other companies in the area are coming to our facility and we're getting to meet like so many new people. And then now we're going to start doing one where we incorporate different project managers throughout the area as well and be able to have our own sort of like lessons learned, or let's talk about like a huge project that someone's been working on and like what went well, what didn't go well. So it's cool to be able to have that level of engagement with people that didn't know this type of community even existed.
That's really neat, actually. I like that idea. It really makes me think about that, you know, and kind of just sort of determining, like, the role that we all have to play in that sort of interdisciplinary understanding, right? So, obviously, it helps to know other skills and what everyone else is doing on the team. But I was curious about what are some of the things you guys have had to do or have done in order to try and get your teams on board with understanding each other's roles? Like, what does a PM do? Or, hey, developers, this is what your designer is doing, vice versa. Like, why is it important? So Larissa, tell me some kind of things that you've had to do in the past to kind of, I guess, keep your team all on the up and up about each other's roles.
Sure. So I think number one in that is collaboration. I like to make sure even at the estimating phase that I'm planning for time within the project to have people meeting constantly together. Like, I'm doing a pretty big website build right now with a team, and we're, they all happen to sit really closely with each other, which is really helpful, but we're making sure, you know, we've got, we have a chat room set up specifically for the project, so if my architect is trying to put together a wireframe, he's got the developer right there. Like, he can say, hey, I think I want to add this feature, but I'm not really sure if that's going to work in the CMS or if we're going to be able to build that. And he'll respond right away and say, you know what, like, that's going to add scope, or we can adjust that. And then, like, I'm in the room with them. So I think that constant collaboration, it keeps everybody engaged because they constantly feel like they're not just getting something handed off to them. Like, they're in it from the beginning, so it makes them just more invested.
Yeah. Do you find that you get any resistance from anybody on the team about having that kind of the necessity for collaboration, or are most people pretty open to it?
I'd say most people are pretty open to it. I know sometimes when we're pretty strapped for time, like, some team members will just be really clear, and I'll tell them to do it as well. You know, if they're really busy, like, please feel free to, like, sign out, or, you know, just post a message and say, like, hey, I'm not going to be available for the next few hours. Like, I'm signing out. If it's an emergency, let me know, but otherwise we can talk later. So that way they have that power to, you know, control their time and whatnot.
Awesome. Yeah, so you kind of give them an out and then the opportunity to check back in when there's time. I like that. That's good. Natalie, what about you? Is there anything that you've done kind of in order to encourage, like, cross-collaboration or just understanding each other's roles?
I always try to frame everything in context. So if I'm saying, hey, like, this design piece has a really quick deadline, I'll explain where the client's coming from, or, you know, if they have an event coming up and they need to impress their managers or something like that. I always try to put everything in context. Like that, and try and reference other team members as needed. So saying, like, well, I have a meeting with the client tomorrow and we've been behind a little bit as a team, so I want to make sure that they have something, telling the designers or developers that there's more of a greater cause behind it. It's not just like, hey, this thing is due, there's a task, do it. And, you know, it's not just a tight deadline, but things like something has to be built a certain way or designed a certain way because of X. So just trying to give greater context to things, I think helps people be aware of who else is working with them too.
Yeah, you know, this kind of makes me think about, so we're talking about if you have a more traditional skill set and you're sort of really harbored in that process and you have to do everything a certain way, I wonder, like, if it does affect the way that people can kind of communicate and let each other know, like, hey, the reason that we're doing this is actually to make sure that everyone's clear on the common goals versus just like, no, I'm telling you that this needs to be done or this is a task that's due it. You know, and I'm not saying that's more of an approach style versus like a methodology or, you know, a certification. But like, Tara, what do you kind of feel like? Do you think that there's any weight to what I just said? Like, what's your take on that?
No, absolutely. I mean, you know, echoing what Larissa and Natalie are saying, it's all about sort of the collaboration and things like that. With us, one of the things that we try and like stress with every project that comes in is that it's not cookie cutter. Like for every one of our clients, what we do is a completely new solution. And they came to us with a challenge and our goal is to solve that challenge. Like we want to fix the problem that they have and they chose us for a reason. And so it's important from our side to make sure that every team member that's involved understands like the role that they play within solving that challenge. Some of the things that we've found that work really well for us is we do, with the entire team, we'll do an internal planning meeting every week so that everyone gets together and it's 15, 20 minutes, but what we're doing is going over, okay, these are the deliverables that we know that we have to, you know, you're dependent on someone else from this team and, you know, everyone kind of is able to talk together and be like, hey, I completely understand that, you know, marketing needs to be able to say, yes, I've got this content assessment ready so that we can go into this UX workshop with the right backing. And we go over like, what are the dependencies on a client? Like what risk are we identifying? And those things really help make sure that everyone on the team knows what their role is and what they're doing.
That's cool. So what kind of thing, Tara, do you find helps in terms of like, using a skill that you have in order to communicate that information? Is there like a thing that kind of comes to mind for you?
Yeah, I think it's honestly being able to facilitate and being able to sort of read a room. I think that's kind of one of the largest skill sets that any project manager that's successful has, and it's the ability to sort of understand the dynamic of the room that you're in, being able to listen and hear what your team members are saying to you, and then being able to help facilitate that conversation. For most project managers, you know, you're not just focused on the single tasks that are at hand, but you're thinking about how those all play into your project plan and how all of that plays into the big picture. And so you're able to say, okay, when we're talking about this, it's going to affect this, and being able to make sure that your team understands that as well. So having that power to facilitate and sort of, you know, listen are huge ways to help make sure things are being successful.
Yeah, no kidding. Larissa, what about you? What do you find is a skill that it kind of helps you to break open that collaboration in those pretty intense meetings?
I find, you know, it's funny. I'm going to give Nancy Lyons a shout out right now. I remember at the Digital Project Management Summit last year, she said something in one of her talks that I actually still have on a post-it at my desk. And it was that you can teach most of the tasking stuff to somebody. You can teach somebody how to be a project manager, but there's this level of emotional intelligence that is sort of required to really do the job well. And I think building on what Tara was saying, you know, being able to really pay attention to like body language and how people are interacting with each other to understand like not just how to get people talking now, but how to get them like an hour from now to really hit the deadlines we're trying to make happen, like especially in a meeting. I think that's a huge part of it. And then I think empathy too. I mean, I constantly put myself in other people's shoes, you know, whether I'm looking at my project team or looking at my client and trying to fix the way that I communicate so that it just works better.
That really hit a chord for me too, because I feel like not only is empathy and emotional intelligence important, but I don't know about if you guys struggle with this, but sometimes I find I'm almost too empathetic. Like I almost need to stop thinking about other people and start thinking about, well, what do I need? And I was curious, like, I want to come back to this because I do want to find out Natalie's take on this too, but remind me to come back to, like, what are some of the things that you guys do for yourselves to sort of put things back in balance if you find that you do what I do and that's just, like, you're exhausted at the end of the day, so don't let me forget that. But Natalie, you have, like, a really unique perspective because you work remotely, like, 100%, right?
Yes, I work remotely all of the time.
And like, yeah, so what do you notice when you're I was going to ask you about like nonverbal communication. Tell me about some of the things if you're doing video chats or if you're doing, you know, other things that kind of weigh in on how you're going to communicate and the skills you'll use to sort of manage those intense meetings.
Yeah, I think with working remotely, a lot of it is things like video chats and anything that's more face-to-face can be a lot more intrusive because I tend to work with people who work from home. So you have to be very like aware of how that might come across in certain situations, if that makes any sense. So we do a lot of voice calls, a lot of chats. I work with a lot of people in different time zones. So it's sort of that always like forced, I guess, clarity in communication. So those relationships that I make with clients or coworkers are very intentional. It's not like I'm seeing them every day. I'm not walking by them with a cup of coffee or anything. I have to make sure to say hi to everyone and make sure to ask what's going on and how they're doing on a project. And I think it's everyone's sort of tendency to be quiet if things are an issue and then be like, oh, I'm gonna make this perfect and, you know, I'll show them, it'll be great. But they disappear. So just always fostering that openness and that comfort level that you would have in an office is really important, whether it's a client or a coworker when you're working remotely. So I think going back to what Larissa said, and you were mentioning, Rachel, empathy is huge with that. Like really understanding that nothing is personal, everyone's coming from a different place, and like putting yourself in their shoes and taking a step back and understanding where that's coming from and the best way to move forward from that is huge.
Yeah. I was gonna ask you on that same point. So I have a friend who's a freelancer, and she had a recent encounter where because she didn't have an actual formal office, she's sort of like using co-working spaces and stuff. A client that she was doing a brand new like they were setting up their initial business development meeting, and basically that client was like just given her crap because she didn't have an office, and how could she take herself seriously as, you know, as a designer? And I was curious, because you straddle, you know, the designer and the project manager role, tell me, like, have you ever encountered that before? Or how do you sort of, how would you address something like that?
I've been lucky. I haven't been up against something that I think aggressive, but I do get comments here and there from family or friends or, you know, other people in other positions where like, oh, they say like, oh, working from home, you must never, you know, get dressed or you must be able to sleep whenever you want or things like that. And yeah, I can wear sweatpants whenever, you know, sometimes my cat wanders into video calls. But you're still doing a job. And I think especially as project managers, it's interesting because we have the sort of forward-facing role in a lot of ways. We have to be presentable to the team. We have to be pulling everyone together. If we're client-facing, we have to talk to clients and be professional in that way. So I don't know that I've ever faced anything quite that aggressive, but I think in that case, it's sort of the other person has the wrong attitude. I don't think that where you work from informs your work if you're good at what you do.
Good call. Yeah, it's all about that. It's not a fit for us, right? That idea of
Yeah.
setting the stage and setting boundaries right from the get-go. I like that. That's really awesome. Okay, so we're just starting to talk a little bit about hard things that we've had to deal with. And I mean, project management is not an easy job to do. Like you've got to be on the ball. You've got to understand and take crap from both sides if you're working with clients and your team, and you've got to be okay with it, right? So, Tara, tell me about what's like the hardest thing you remember having to do as a PM?
Oh, it's the difficult conversation. That is always the hardest thing to do. Whether it's you effed up and you have to own up to it, or you're not going to hit a deadline, or you're running through budget, it's almost as bad as when your parents look at you and they say they're not mad, they're just disappointed. And you're having to deal with that with your client who has put like their entire faith of this, you know, child to them in your hands, and you effed up, like you messed up, and you have to have that conversation. And I don't think it ever gets easier. It's just, you know, it's one of those things that you have to have thick skin, and you've got to understand that you're only going to make it worse if you try and hide from a bad situation. So it's, you know, owning up to it, admitting fault, and but coming with the solution of how you're what you're doing to actually make it better. But God knows, I hate every single time I have to have that difficult conversation.
Which they happen quite frequently, right? They have to, because you're always checks and balances, right? Do you have like a specific story that you could think of that you would be able to tell, or?
Oh, so I probably have like 1,000, which then makes it sound like I'm a horrible project manager. I swear I'm not bad at this. but I'm the one that does, because I also sort of oversee project managers and account managers. So I get pulled in to have the difficult conversation for others. One that stands out in mind is we had a client and we were developing a brand new application for them, like from the ground up. And we missed an entire database that was like the backbone of what they were doing. And it wasn't just like my team that I was working with missed it. It got missed through sales. It got missed through the discovery phase. It got missed through the design phase. Like it got missed like multiple times. And then all of a sudden the developer came to me and he was like, Tara, this isn't going to work without this. Like, what are we going to do? And we were set to go live in like less than a month. And so we basically had to call up the client and say, you know what? We messed up. Like, there's an entire component to your system that we didn't even realize existed. And we're not going to hit this deadline. Like, we're not going to do that. And what makes it even worse is that because we didn't budget for it, we need to issue a change order to be able to get you guys to pay for our miss. And the client was, you know, mad, but at the same time, you know, because we were open and honest about it right when we discovered it, you know, we were able to work together and we came up with a solution that, you know, we actually were able to get things done and we rolled out like 2 weeks late, but it wasn't as bad as it could have been. And, you know, we met in the middle on what the cost was going to be. So we didn't really lose money. We only lost a couple of weeks of the schedule, but we saved face with the client.
That's pretty incredible. You guys pulled that off the ledge. That's like a huge success story.
It you know, it's like you always have like those sort of moments where it's either you guys totally messed up or have like that nightmare client, but together as a team. And that's what I always kind of think about is like if I was in the shoes of my team and, you know, if my developer, like we're never going to write perfect code. So if my developer like messed up on something, I've got my teammates back and I'm going to go to bat for them and have that conversation. And, you know, it's like as long as everyone's kind of working together, I think you can turn any bad situation into a good situation.
Yeah, no kidding. You just have to have the good conversations along with the bad ones. I think that's right. You got to have your teams back. I'm interested, Larissa, tell us about your story. Do you have a specific one?
Oh, my gosh. I really want to build on what Tara was talking about. I mean, I was talking about this yesterday with someone, actually. Like, I think having transparency from the very beginning about everything is really what's going to help you have those difficult conversations, because that's definitely the worst part of the job. But it makes it better in the end, because if you can come to your client and say, you know what, yeah, like, we screwed up, or we forgot to scope this, or something drastic. I just recently had a web build that we're doing where a developer, the only developer I had on the project, actually quit. And and it was a little bit late to begin with because of some issues, but so he quit. And now that we've reassigned the project so that we can finish it, we've realized that a lot of what was written is not actually viable. And they were things that you wouldn't be able to tell right off the bat unless you were really diving into the code. So that's a really, really hard conversation to have with a client when they're already okay with us having extended their deadline, and now you're telling them, you know what, like, we're actually going to probably push it out about a month and a half. But I think going through the entire process with them and being very transparent and very honest and just saying, you know what, like, this is totally on us, and being able to provide or anticipate the questions they'll have about that, like, okay, well, is it going to cost more? Is it, you know, what's our potential delivery date pushed out to now? You know, how are we mitigating other risks, and how are we making sure that the code that's being written now is not having that problem? Being able to go into that conversation with those answers, I mean, it just makes the conversation a lot easier.
Mm-hmm. And that is tough. That's rough stuff. Yeah. So, yeah, okay, so tell me, Natalie, like, in your situation, working remotely too, do you have any other sort of stories that come to mind?
I think the hardest is, in general, just like admitting that I was wrong about something or messed up. So there was a small project I was working on a few months ago where, on top of everything else, it just kept slipping through. The contact I was working with, the developer, was in a different time zone and offset by a lot. So I would often like start signing off and then for the day and like realize I hadn't assigned work and it wouldn't get done if I didn't assign it before that evening. So there's just like a lot of back and forth with tasks being assigned at maybe the wrong time or a little too late. Things would be offset by an entire day if they were done. Questions, like very basic questions about access and stuff, were overlooked from the start just because everything else was going on. And I felt so bad because the client was wonderful and so understanding every time. They were like, hey, where's this project that we talked about 2 weeks ago? And it's one of those things where you have to realize that even if someone's quiet, they might still have an issue with something, and that's where that like upfront communication is so important. And if something does go wrong, saying like, hey, I know this was my fault, I apologize, I'll be a lot more proactive with the team, with myself, with the project. So I think that kind of thing has been what tripped me up in the past, and then I feel really bad about it because they were so good about it the whole time. It's even harder to admit that it was totally my fault or something like that.
Man, do you have any phrases that you use to sort of get that information? Like, are you okay? Like, how do you approach that?
I'm a huge fan of just checking in regularly. So with most of my clients, I try to at least shoot them one email a week if I don't hear from them, if something's in a really busy phase. If it's really busy, I'll try to do a call a week, even if there's not a lot of visual progress or nothing that they can look at. It's nice to just reconnect and say like, hey, you're in the front of my mind right now. We're still working on what your project is all about. Like, here's a few questions we came up with along the way, or just how are you doing? Do you have anything to ask me? And making sure that they know that you're there, especially since there's not necessarily a physical location that they can come back to for you.
Yeah, no kidding. It brings me back to like working with a few freelancers, and I feel like some of them get so overwhelmed with doing the day-to-day work that with that PM hat that they have to wear, they're almost like, well, I don't have time to do regular progress reports or updates or checks. And ironically, like, that's probably just as important, or if not more important, than the work itself, right? Because more than anything, a client just wants to know that you've got their back, they're moving forward, and the money that they're putting into this project is going to come out again in a nice shape, right? So kind of shocking to me that that people avoid A, those tough conversations. They sort of abandon like just the follow-up process. What do you guys why do you think that happens? Like, what is it about that? And I guess it's PMs are, that's our job description, but what kind of advice do you have for somebody who is not primarily a digital project manager? Say they're even an agency owner or something like that. Like, what would you say, Tara or Natalie, about like giving that kind of advice?
Oh, like the advice of like, hey, guess what? You can't just ignore a person. You have to actually follow up. I kind of think about it as, you know, look at it from your own day to day. If you get agitated when someone doesn't respond to you, when you are just even trying to get like something done around your house and you wait like 4 days to hear back of whether or not a contractor is going to be able to show up, that's the way your clients are going to feel if you don't reach out and let them know. And I think the biggest thing that, you know, piece of advice is to let people realize that for your clients, this isn't their job. Like, it's not their job to be your client. This isn't the only thing that they're working on. And they are just as busy as you are, if not more so. You know, the project that you're doing with one of your clients, it's just something that got handed to them. But they need to feel like they are the most important thing to you. And it really doesn't take that long just to send a quick note out, like just saying, hey, I got your email. I'll give you a bigger, like a longer description later on, but just wanted to let you know that I got your email, or, hey, haven't forgotten about you, I'm checking in. And the other like biggest piece of advice that I think I could give to people when it comes to communication is that if you find yourself struggling to write an email because you've got so much information in it, that means what you're saying shouldn't be in an email. Pick up the phone and have a conversation. I don't understand why people think it's so difficult to actually like talk to someone. We live our lives through like text messages and hip chats and Slack messages. Like, it's okay to have a phone conversation, talk to people.
Totally. That's a very reasonable request, I'd say. And I think, too, at the same time, like, there's that sort of, well, we want to make sure we have a paper trail. So making sure that however you do have that phone call, that there's still a backup. It's either recorded or you've got notes or something that's going to make sure that, like, the client's like, well, remember when we talked, you said that was going to be free. So how do you guys deal with that?
I don't think any of us ever say, no, that was free. Totally. You get everything for free. No, but it's... We operate in a mindset of where it's always CYA. Like, we don't always have to cover our asses, you know? It's, if you have that conversation, send a follow-up email. Half the time you're sitting at your computer anyways, while you're talking, type your notes, and then hit send. It's not that complicated.
I love it. That's wicked. Okay, you guys, so we have a little bit of time left, and I just wanted to draw something back to our industry. So there is good stuff about our industry. There's bad stuff about our industry. We know that. Recently, Sam Barnes sent a video in our Slack channel, and it was from a web stock thing done in 2013, and Mike Montero was talking about the state of our industry. And I don't know if you guys had a chance to watch it, but in it, basically, Mike was highlighting the fact that we need to be better, right? Our clients... Like Tara, you just talked about, their job is their job. They have a whole business to run. Our job is to make sure that they're feeling supported and managed, right? So when we talk about making our industry better, I want to know, what do you guys think, A, is really suffering? And what do you think, B, is something that we can do about it? Larissa, what do you think?
Something that I notice that's suffering, and I don't know if it's just Phoenix or just, I don't know what I could put my finger on for it, but I feel like there's really a necessity to be successful as a digital project manager, you really need to educate yourself about the discipline to manage. You have to understand content strategy. You have to understand UX and design and development and all these different development languages and how they fit together. Because you're really the front line for your client. Like, you are the main contact. I mean, I like to have my team talk directly to the client as much as possible. But at the end of the day, I mean, if the client freaks out about something, typically you're the one they call. And I feel like moving forward, I mean, that's something that we really need to step up our game on. Like, we should be able to jump into a conversation very fluidly, no matter what the topic is, and be able to speak to that. And also, at the end of the day, too, if we get into that conversation and it gets, like, really deep, also be able to say, I don't know, instead of just continuing to speak and thinking that you're right, because the client's going to believe you, and then you might say something that could completely screw your project.
Yeah, no kidding. I think you nailed that one for sure. Natalie, what do you think?
I think in a broader sense, there's still such a stigma of, like, the best design or the best development or best whatever happens in these huge cities. And I'm, like, super involved in the local design and development scene. I'm a huge proponent of, like, you can be a great whatever wherever you are, as long as you have community support or are proud of your work and doing well. And I think there's still sort of that belief in our industry that, like, all of the best whatever comes out of San Francisco or New York City or whatever, and you have to be based there if you want a great site. And I don't think that's true at all. But on a more, I guess, focused sense, in terms of agencies and what we do, I agree with Larissa completely. Education is so huge, and being able to speak to what you're doing and what your clients' needs are and what your team is doing is so important in what we do, and even understanding what everyone around us does. And being able to understand when you're out of your element and when you need to ask more questions or get someone else involved. I think it's really scary to admit you don't know something, but it's really important for us to be able to do.
That vulnerability is super important, isn't it? Mm-hmm. Tara, do you have anything you want to add to that?
No, I mean, I think both of them kind of covered it perfectly. It's, you know, we aren't always going to have the answer, and we can't pretend that we do, because it's just going to make something worse. I think, you know, kind of to the point of what Mike was saying in his talk of, you know, we're making bad business decisions, or we're not producing good design. I think Where you start to see that struggle is when a company stops remembering why they got into the job in the first place, or why a freelancer or a designer does what they do. And it's kind of like when you start to lose that passion, it becomes lost in the work that you're doing. And it's, you know, God knows, the moment that I start losing passion for being a project manager and doing what I do every single day, I'm frightened, because this is what I know and what I love. And when that happens to people, that they just kind of lose that passion, it's completely visible in the work that they're producing.
Mm-hmm. I don't know if you ladies have felt this way, but there's, like, I tend to be a bit of a squeaky wheel. Like, I don't know if I would play nice with others, in the fact that when there's something where I feel like there's, you know, justice is not being served, or people are not, you know, their best interests are not being looked at, I will speak up. I will say something. And that's gotten me into hot water a lot of times. And I was curious about this because I think it does speak to, I think Sam talked about this briefly, and Mike was just talking about, like, you need to be willing to, like, say no and no more, and I will not do this. And I was curious if, how do you guys feel about that? Like, have you had to make decisions in your work, any job, that have put you in a place where you do not believe in what you're doing? What do you think, Larissa?
I kind of get in a situation where I don't think I necessarily play well with others all the time. Because I just, in general, I have a really hard time putting up with bullshit. Mm-hmm. I feel like, you know, we spend, you know, 40, 50 hours a week doing this job. It's really stressful. There's a lot of balls in the air. And when I start dealing with situations where it's just like, you know, corporate jargon and wasteful meetings and things, and, you know, having output that's just not to quality, I'm really direct about that. And not in a rude way. I mean, I try really hard not to be, but, like, I'm really passionate about design. I think that, you know, design and what we do really can solve serious problems for companies, and I think that's why I do this. And so I have a really hard time when, you know, when maybe, like, the company gets really busy and everybody's so stressed out and working overtime that the quality of work starts to suffer because there's no time for creativity. And I have no problem speaking up, but it can certainly bite me in the ass.
Yeah, I think it has the capacity to do that, but I think there's something to the fact that we are basically the torch in that group, right? And we are tasked with keeping things on track, but also heading the right direction. And I think it's very brave to do that. Natalie, have you had to do that in your situation?
Yeah, I've definitely been in situations in the past where, you know, all of these magical marketing and design and development solutions are being presented to a client, and in reality, they have a very, very small budget. You know, it's a two-person family shop. Locally, they don't need the best of the best, and they certainly need the best of something, and we can provide it to them, but there's a line between what's functional and needed and finding a way to incorporate really good design and development, and then, you know, then there's, like, the dream sites that are, like, humongous budgets, unlimited marketing. And I think a lot of people tend to oversell themselves that way. And there's, I mean, if you just Google search, like, web design or web development, you're going to find a lot of crap out there, or a lot of people trying to oversell you things. So I think as a PM, I've definitely been in a situation where I felt like it's my duty to sort of say, like, no, this isn't right for the client, and we're just going to get ourselves in hot water if we do this. It's important to look out for their needs.
Yeah, and I think what you kind of hit on there is part of what I think we all agree, that there is no room for ego in the work that we do. And I think that, and even Mike said, like, in the design world, there should not be room for ego, and even development. Like, yes, people are doing and creating amazing things. Yes, they are solving problems and hopefully solving really important problems. But the moment that the team is suddenly focused on what we do, what we make for you, it's like you've lost the goal, which is, what does the client need, right? What are we really trying to fix, and how are we really trying to solve that? And so I guess my personal struggle is that when I come, like, face to face with ego, like, I will just, like, blow it up. Like, I will probably be that person that everyone's like, shut up. And I just wondered, like, Tara, how do you feel about that? Like, do you do you get like upset when people kind of have the big egos that come into the room? Like, how do you respond to that?
God, sometimes I just want to like reach across the table and strangle them, but then I realize you can't really do that. Like, physical harm is never good for any meeting. But you know, to kind of pose a question to the group, like we've all dealt with big egos from internal teams.
Yeah.
You know? And we've all worked with like the person that thinks they're the absolute best at what they do, and they won't listen to you when you're trying to give them like constructive criticism on, you know, a design element because you know what works best for your client. But have you guys been put into the situation where your client is the big ego in the room and you're having to deal with trying to bring them back down to earth? And I've been stuck in situations where I had enough, to where I have gotten myself in trouble in the sense that I stopped a project. Like, while a client was, I was listening to, we had like four clients that were all in a room and they were all arguing with one another about what they were trying to accomplish. And I asked them to stop. And I was like, guys, I'm going to pull my team out of this room and we're not going to work with you anymore until you guys can stop acting like children and actually come to us with what you need and not argue in front of us, because you're wasting your time and budget by being children. And have like you guys ever been put in that situation where it's the client has the big ego and you're having to tell them to like shut up?
Well, first of all, it's pretty badass. But yeah, tell me, Larissa, have you had that happen?
I can jump in if you don't mind, Larissa, but I've definitely been in that situation. And I think a lot of times, too, it was reinforced because when I first started, I was very young. So it was sort of the double-edged sword of, like, they had egos and also didn't believe me and didn't believe that I had the authority. But in some cases, I've done almost exactly the same thing as Tara, though not quite as cool. But basically, telling a client, like, all of this arguing or, you know, back and forth or whatever it is going into your budget and we're charging you and we really want to give you a quality product, so you need to decide what you're doing before we continue on this project. And in other cases, if it's not a huge deal but it's taking up a lot of time, like if they're so certain that their idea for a design is like the most important thing in the world, we've kind of found a way in the past to meet them halfway and sort of do it and or wireframe it or something and say, like, this is why it's not going to work, but here's our really great solution, and this is what you're paying us money for, and by the way, there are all these benefits to doing it this way. And it's a little milder, and hopefully you can sort of push them in the right direction, and I think in some cases that works. In other cases, you just have to be really blunt, and that's always hard to do, I think, but also part of our jobs.
Yeah. I was going to, so that's sort of, I mean, a similar situation with me. And I think part of it was that my point of contact had made promises as a new hire to the company and saying that, well, don't worry, we have this great web agency and they're going to come in and they're going to do all this for this much. And somehow that got translated beyond my knowledge. And so then all of a sudden it was very much fronting a lot of ego and a lot of like, well, listen, you said blah, blah, blah. So for me, it was like, how do you call this out? Recognizing that decisions were made beyond my control. So coming in and trying to take the reins and just being like, we're going to shift things. And to be very honest, that project, I just was like, fuck this. And I actually got off that project because there was no way for me to work through that ego and that relationship and the things that had been promised outside of me. It was like set up to fail, right? And it feels awful when that happens because you feel like, yeah, like basically you screwed up and you failed. But I also am okay with that fact because I know I did whatever I could to try to put it back on the rails, and it was just like, it was just not happening in that way. So, but I was going to say, Larissa, did you have anything to add? We're going to bring this home pretty soon. So I just wanted to see how you guys are doing.
Yeah, I mean, I think I've definitely been in the room where people start, you know, people on the client side, if you have lots of stakeholders and lots of differing opinions from lots of different high level executives. I think it's really hard to get them on the same page. And I recently went through a project where we did a lot of stakeholder interviews and individually interviewed everybody, but then we came together to present the results. We didn't name anyone, and we just sort of said, okay, look, you know, based upon your executive team, these are the goals we're coming out with for the entire project. And they were so all over the place that the client realized, you know what, like, we're not on the same page at all. And then we demonstrated to them too. I was like, you know, it's really hard to try and create something that'll accomplish all of these different goals. So our advice is either A, like, let's have a workshop where we can facilitate for you guys to really work through the current issues on your site and figure out what needs to be fixed. Or if you guys want to meet internally, it'll save you some money because I know you've got a really tight budget. Mm-hmm. So meet internally, figure this out, and then let's sort of like regroup in a week and see what we can work on. But it's hard to say that, you know, you've got your swings, people come to you for your expertise. Like, you know, it's weird because it's like, you know, I'm just like this project manager at an agency that they're trying to work with. And here's these super high level executives that are experts in their industry, but it's kind of hard to turn around and say, you know what, like, this isn't going to work mm-hmm. at all. But at the end of the day, I mean, you're really just protecting their interests and you're saving them money in the long run.
I like that, actually, that approach. Can I borrow that? That's that's a really good way to do it. So I think I wanted to kind of come back to you. So first of all, yes or no, do you feel that as a majority, digital project managers are supported and upheld by their companies? So, Larissa, yes or no?
Sometimes.
Sometimes. Okay.
Yes. Sometimes. I think it depends on the company.
Yes.
But yes.
Definitely.
I mean, yeah.
Natalie, yes or no, or a short?
I think it depends on the company also, but I've put myself in a situation where I'm definitely being supported as a PM and recognized as that.
Definitely. And this is not personal. This is just as a whole, how do we feel about the sort of field of digital project management and whether or not, like, how far do we have to go? Anything to add, Tara?
I think wholeheartedly 100% from my company, and I think it's getting better as the definition of what a digital project manager is becomes more defined.
Right. And of course, part of that is about us building this community to help people have the language to be able to describe what they do, how they do it, and how that role needs to shift and change. So I was going to leave us with two questions. So the first one is, what would you say to a digital PM who's feeling super burned out? And then on that second part, what would you say to sort of help support that digital PM and, like, actually create a more strengthened community? So what would you say to help a burned out PM, and what would you say to help strengthen this community? Larissa.
I would probably tell them that it's not always as stressful as I think it is. Because, I mean, I definitely have moments where I'm just like, oh my God, like, I can't go back, you know? Sometimes you just have a week where it just gets crazy. Mm-hmm. But I think the biggest thing is just remembering that, you know what, like, we're the backbone of a project, you know? And we're not there necessarily supporting just the client or just the team. We're supporting the project. And so there's going to be really horrible weeks. And then there's going to be really amazing weeks, and they balance each other out, and it's worth it just to keep going. And then as far as the community goes, I think another piece of advice that I'd give that PM too is to join the community and get involved, because I feel like the biggest resource I have is the DPM community across the country, or across the world, really. Like, the people that I've met through the summit, through the Slack channel, I mean, that's really, like, that's my inspiration for getting people involved and trying to, like, bring more of that to Phoenix and trying to bring more of that to other people that I talk with. And so I think that's probably the biggest thing.
So did you hear that, everybody else out there? You guys, if you're living in a city where you don't have access to a digital PM meetup group, consider just starting your own. If they're super, like, easy, pretty quick to start up, and if you have two or three volunteers to help those get started, you guys can reach out to us. We'll share all of our Twitter handles and everything. If you need any support, hopefully you ladies would be open to sharing some of your tips and your wisdom around how to do that, because I think that's the key, Larissa. You're right. We need to absolutely get more people on board, because I feel like the network right now is very, like, there's still holes. There's giant holes in it. And there are parts of, like, I think someone reached out to me in Ohio and said, like, there's nothing. I have no support, and I don't even know how to start. So that's a super good point. Natalie, what else? What would you say to someone who's super burnt out, and how would you, how could we help build this community?
To someone who is super burned out, I would say take time for yourself. I think being a burned out PM, it's so hard to take others' needs before your own. It's so hard not to fly off the handle at something smaller or to keep emotions out of it. So take the time for yourself, like take a weekend and unplug, take like one day off of work or something. And even if you think you can't, you can just unplug and take that time. It's so important to take care of ourselves because we take the brunt of a lot of things. I would definitely echo Larissa's comment about joining the community. I would say, find other PMs, people you've worked with in the past, your fellow PMs, if you're sick of them, find a friend who maybe manages something in a similar way, join a community, create your community, or even just like start talking to people locally. It helps so much to get other perspectives. And like when I started going to the PM conference and my PM meetups, just hearing other people's experiences, it's so incredible to hear their experiences echo your own. It's so important to get that feedback and perspective. It really helps.
I totally agree. And I think a lot of that has to do with the fact that, I don't know, sometimes like you work so hard and you do burn yourself out at both ends being a digital PM. And sometimes like we need to feel okay. We need to have someone telling us we're doing a good job and we're, you know, we don't have to have everything figured out all at once. And I think that that's like so important. And also on that same note, I feel like super grateful to even be able to have you ladies to be able to bounce ideas off of. And just when we've had a shit day, we can say that. And it's okay because there's no like, oh, what? You don't know what you're doing. No, we're just okay. And so I thank you for that. And Tara, I wanted to just, open it up. What's your sort of thoughts? What would you tell somebody who's at the end of the rope? They're, you know, maybe considering quitting the fields or moving into a new job altogether. And what would you do to try to build a community?
Yeah, so I guess the best advice, I mean, these girls have nailed it, but it's, you know, just sit back, take a breath, and realize that everything will eventually get done. It doesn't have to get done right that very second. And it's almost, you know, project manage yourself. Take a look at that ginormous task list that you can't seem to ever get anything crossed off of and find out, like, if you could accomplish one thing from that list, how would it help you be in a better spot? And do that one thing. And for me, leave your computer at home. Like, when you're done for the day, you're done. Like, stay off of it, you know? Enjoy the outdoors, spend time with your family, play with your pets, you know, go have a cocktail, just get away from work. Because if you're constantly in front of your computer, on your phone, on your iPad, you're never going to stop. And then you're only going to get yourself more burnt out. So you've got to put down the like electronics and just focus on yourself. And for, you know, getting involved, like absolutely join the community. Shout out to Brett, find him and get part of the Digital PM Summit. Like meeting you ladies and meeting all the people that I did at the very first summit 2 years ago has made me a better project manager. I have mentors in all of you, and that's what I would say everyone needs is find someone that could be your mentor, get involved in the community, and find someone that can be your sounding board, because if someone understands what you're going through, they're going to be able to help you get through it so that you don't feel like you have to quit.
Yeah, absolutely. We can't let ourselves be alone out there. This world and this industry changes so fast, and so today what we're doing might have to change tomorrow. And I think that without each other, I mean, yeah, like Terry, I think you hit it on the head, and you heard her, put down the electronics at the end of the day. So before we wrap up, I want to ask you guys, what is the thing that you are going to do this weekend for yourself, each of you? What are you going to do? Tara.
Oh, I was like, so I am throwing a crawfish boil tomorrow, and I have 120 people that are showing up at my house for 90 pounds of crawfish and 15 gallons of bourbon soda. So I'll be drinking bourbon and eating crawfish. Y'all are free to come. Amazing. Anyone want to come, just come hang out.
That doesn't sound relaxing as far as the setting up part, but afterwards.
Oh, no. We've done this now. This is like our fifth year. So it's like it's under control. Like we don't even have to worry about it. It's like just get some tents up, get the crawfish in, let it boil, and then drink a lot of bourbon. So it's perfect.
on that note,
I feel like Paris has gone last.
We should seriously talk about, like, DPM Philly. If we can get in a little early, maybe we do something, you know, like have a little mini spread and we just do like an event for ourselves. I think that'd be pretty fun. So what about you, Larissa? What are you going to do for yourself this weekend?
Damn, well, it's not that exciting.
Tara.
So my fiance and I are going over to my mom's tomorrow. We have part of our wedding favor is that we're actually branding wood sliced coasters. So we're going to do that tomorrow. So we're going to play with fire and drink some bourbon. And then I think Sunday I have plans to do absolutely nothing. So that will be delightful.
That sounds delightful. I like that. And so do you guys have your own brands? You made brands for the coasters?
Yeah, my friend Nikki actually is a brilliant designer, and she offered to do basically like almost like a logo for us. So she created a design, and we really fell in love with it. And I found this custom branding artist who makes branding irons on Etsy, of course, because you can find everything there. And we had him make it for us, and it's perfect. So yeah, that'll be a fun project tomorrow.
It's a weekend. I think I'm totally in 100% support, as long as you guys don't get weird and like try to brand yourselves after as like in place of a wedding ring, because that just it's a little extreme. So stick to the coasters. Yeah, good deal. Natalie, how about you? What are you gonna do for yourself this weekend?
I'm going to yoga, and then probably the farmer's market. I'm going to see Hamlet. One of the local theaters is putting it on. It's supposed to be really good. And then, it's the annual Greek festival in Albany, which is always a really fun time. So lots of fun activities. And I'm really happy that none of us are doing anything with computers. It sounds awesome.
Yes, absolutely. I can say that I'm also going to be doing something fun too, going to a giant wedding, 400-person Sikh wedding, and that'll be a fantastic experience, and I'm really looking forward to that. And then Sunday, I'm not doing shit. So, yeah, I think that I'm glad to hear that you guys are looking after yourselves, that we're all, you know, it's hard. It is really hard to turn off. I'm starting to realize that, like, that self that was like, Travis, why do you gotta check your email, like, more than once a day? That me doesn't exist anymore. This me is like, I have to force myself to put it down. And I never thought that that would happen. So I think it's like almost like a foreboding warning, right? Like, no matter what, if you don't make a point of disconnecting and turning things off and actually like reaching out to other people through other ways, it just sneaks up on you. And we, like, you guys agree, right? We cannot take our jobs too seriously. You know, we're helping make websites and apps, but we're not, you know, we're not rocket scientists, brain surgeons. Like, we need to not take ourselves too seriously. So anyways, yeah. I just super, super thank you, super thankful for you guys being able to join us. And so if we wanted to find you, Tara, where would we find you on the internet?
You can find me at my blog, iamtara.com, or you can follow me on Twitter at T Called Simon, and Instagram, everything's under T Called Simon. So if you find that, you'll find me.
All right. And we'll have all this written down for you guys so you can find people. Larissa, how do we find you?
You can find me on Twitter at Larissa Scordato, and the same for Instagram as well. Although my Instagram is probably mostly pictures of my dog and or bourbon. So if you like that kind of thing.
I like those things. And Natalie, what about you?
You can find me on Twitter at TalkaNatalka, and same with the website, TalkaNatalka.com.
I gotta know, where did you come up with that handle? That's pretty fantastic.
I should maybe explain this someday, but my name in Ukrainian is Natalka, Natalie Natalka, and my family calls me Talka for short, so it's just Talka Natalka.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
That makes way more sense, because I thought it was just like talking and that. Yeah, talk. Anyways.
Yeah.
Yeah. I got the last name right. Give me 50%. I'll take it.
Yeah, you were the first person to get it right on the first try, yes. So congratulations.
That's fantastic. So you guys, you can find me, Rachel Gertz. I'm on Twitter at The Stray Muse. I have to apologize in advance. It's not the work version of me, which is slightly more professional. So just be prepared for what you get. And I want to wrap it up by saying, yeah, a huge thank you to all of you. Each and every one of you guys is helping us to make this place, this digital place, a better place for project managers. But I think I think that other people are catching on and they're starting to see this stuff. I'm getting a lot of freelancers, a lot of designers, even developers and owners showing up to meetups now that we're running, and they're getting more and more curious. And I think that that's amazing, because like, in no way are we trying to limit this to like, this is just our movement. It's like, everybody get on board. We're doing this. We're making things better. So thank you for being a part of that. I just want you to have a fantastic weekend. And yeah, do you guys have any final thoughts, final words you want to shout out?
No, I would just say thank you so much for inviting me. This is really fun.
We'll do it again, I think. I think we should do it again.
Yeah, I like having the all-girl group. It's awesome.
Yeah, we are. Why don't you do it again? Powerhouses in the house. Yeah. All right, you guys have a fantastic weekend, and I will catch up with you soon. See you later.
Thank you.
Bye, guys.